after 40 shows and an election. This is our last programme for 2023, and as we go to air this morning, the 54th Parliament is preparing to open for the first time. Their first order of business will be to appoint the Speaker before the Governor-General makes her speech from the throne. The House will then sit under urgency as the new coalition government pursues an aggressive agenda before the summer break. A few minutes ago, I spoke with the new Leader of the House, and I began by asking Chris Bishop what will be passed before Christmas.
So Parliament's going to start sitting on Tuesday. We've got a whole bunch of procedural stuff to go through, electing the Speaker, having the state opening, the speech from the throne, first question time, and then from the second week of the House sitting period, we'll start to legislate. So the first bill that the government will move will be the legislation to return the Reserve Bank to a single focus on price stability, keeping inflation under 3%. And so we want to put that through all stages. And we can do that by Christmas, quite a simple change to the Reserve Bank of New Zealand Act. And we're also going to repeal the fair pay legislation, or so-called fair pay legislation. Again, quite a simple repeal bill. We're also going to repeal the Natural Built Environment Act and the Spatial Planning Act. That's Labor's changes to the RMA, which got passed in October. So again, those issues have been well ventilated. Again, quite a simple repeal bill, and also the clean car discount, which is the so-called ute tax. So we'll get that out of the way by Christmas, and that's due to stop on the 31st of December, so it requires legislation to do.
You're going to be legislating using urgency, and of course in the past, at times, you have been a vocal critic of the use of urgency. Why is urgency justified in this case?
Yes, I have, and I should signal that over the life of this Parliament and this government, we will seek to use urgently, sparingly, and where it's required. And in this instance, I think it's justified for two reasons. Number one, on all of the legislation we're moving, the three parties sought a mandate for at the election, and actually explicitly in the case of at least National and ACT said that the Natural Built Environment Act, for example, should be repealed by Christmas, given it had only just been passed, and we sought a mandate for that at the election, and we received that mandate from New Zealanders. And then the second thing I would say to you is that a lot of these bills are repeal bills, and in some cases they repeal legislation that's only just been passed. So in the case of the RMA, for example, or the Natural Built Environment Act, that only got passed by the Parliament in October, so the last Parliament went through a long and convoluted process to pass it. Mandate at the election was to repeal it, and it's a simple repeal bill. These are not technical bills that require, you know, deep dives at select committee, lots of consultation. They're relatively simple, and that's why we're comfortable advancing them.
Yeah, by my count, at least 20 of the actions listed in your 100-day plan are plans to repeal or replace or remove legislation to stop work that's underway. When will New Zealanders see the first piece of legislation passed that actually builds something new, if you like?
You'll see legislation in the new year. So our focus before Christmas is on getting stuff off the statute books that we just want to stop work on. So the Natural Built Environment Act, for example, has a huge swathe of things that councils have to do unless it's no longer the law. So we need to get it off the statute books. The clean car discount, we've signalled we want that to stop on 31st December, 1st of January, New Year, it requires legislation. So there's a bit of time pressure on some of these things before Christmas. In the new year, you'll start to see legislation around Three Waters, for example. You'll start to see legislation potentially around setting up a national infrastructure agency. There's some of the things around law and order in the youth justice space. There's a lot of work that's already been started by ministers on that. And so let me tell you, when we come back in the new year, there'll be a very busy legislative period as well.
So when you look at those big reforms that are being repealed, and I think the likes of RMA 2.0 and Three Waters, when can New Zealanders expect comprehensive replacements to be in place for Three Waters and the RMA?
We'll be making further announcements about that in due course. Simeon Browns, who's the Minister of Local Government, alongside myself, we're doing some quite heavy lifting. We've already taken advice on how to get started on that Three Waters replacement legislation. It's part of our 100-day plan to introduce legislation to repeal and replace the Three Waters regime. So we're working at pace on that, and we'll be making announcements around that. On the RMA and the resource management space more generally, I'm thinking about it in terms of three phases. The first is get rid of the Natural Built Environment Act, Labor's laws. That'll be done by Christmas. In the new year, I will be bringing legislation to the Parliament to establish a fast-track regime for consents, and I'm working alongside Shane Jones and other ministers on that, and you can expect to see that legislation in the new year, but that will make it easier to get started on infrastructure projects, for example, and you'll see that in the new year. And then the third phase of the resource management reforms is to start on replacement legislation for the RMA, and that will be a longer term process. The aim is to have that into law by the end of the 3 years, but we need to do some quite heavy policy lifting on that and do quite a lot of consultation on that, so that will be a more medium to long term project.
So the first bill of the new government will return the Reserve Bank of New Zealand to a single remit focused on controlling inflation and price stability. It means that they no longer will have a remit to consider unemployment. What will be the impact of that bill on New Zealand's unemployment rate next year?
There would be economists who would be able to give you the exact specifics on that, and it's in Nicola Willis's area. But what I would say to you is that for many years post the Reserve Bank Act 1989, the Reserve Bank was world leading, actually, in the sense of being focused on one thing and not confusing itself with different missions. It was world leading because it focused on price stability, initially the 0 to 2% band for inflation, laterally moved to 1 to 3%. And our view is that keeping the Reserve Bank focused on what it should do, which is monetary policy, focused on getting inflation down, is the best course of action. We sort of mandate for it at the election, and we intend to implement it.
But I mean, the yin to the OCR's yang is that typically a higher OCR, which is used to target inflation, means a higher unemployment rate. And if your government's contention is that the Reserve Bank has been distracted by looking at the unemployment issue over the last couple of years, then surely the flip side to that is that by focusing solely on inflation, we're going to expect a much higher unemployment rate.
I think the point is that governments should focus on the fiscal levers and other policy parameters that you need to take into consideration. The Reserve Bank needs to focus on its job, which is monetary policy. And the best thing we can do for this economy in the medium to long term, and frankly in the short term as well, is get inflation down, because once inflation gets into the arteries of an economy, like it has done over the last few years in New Zealand, it is wealth destructive for so many people. We've seen wages not keeping up with inflation. We've seen the savings of people erode. We've seen businesses not being able to plan. You know, inflation is the scourge of modern economies. We need to get it down, and that's why we want the Reserve Bank focused on it. And of course, we've got a whole range of other productivity enhancing reforms and measures that we want to implement over the next few years to drive economic growth and also productivity growth in the economy.
In your first 100 days, you will repeal those smoke-free changes. Compared to business as usual, do you accept that those changes would have saved lives?
No, I think the evidence is not there on that. The changes are highly speculative. Actually, we're opposed, as I understand it, by some people in the sort of anti-smoking, smoke-free movement. Things like, for example, having one store in Northland that can sell cigarettes, I mean, that store would have to be Fort Knox. It would end up being targets of ram raids and theft and crime. And the idea that just having one store in Northland won't lead to a black market in tobacco and cigarettes.
Where does that one store in Northland come from?
Well, the government published, basically the plan, as I understand it, I'm by no means an expert on it, but as I understand it, the government published a plan to significantly reduce net down the number of retail outlets where you could buy cigarettes. And my understanding is that they basically proposed one store for the Northland region. So people would have to travel, you know, vast distances to cigarettes if they were a smoker.
Yeah, I went through the list that was produced by the Director General of Health in September of this year. So there are going to be 600 stores nationwide, right? I went through the list. Director General had to consider population, smoking rates in different parts of New Zealand. By my count, Northland would have 35 tobacco outlets.
Yeah, well, I haven't seen that list, but my understanding is that, and Northland is one of those examples, but there are other parts of the country.
But you just said one. Hang on a second.
You just said one. Seller of tobacco.
No, but you just said one, and that's
yeah,
what
that's
the,
right. There'd be one store in Northland. That's my understanding. Yes.
That's what the Prime Minister said the other day as well. But the Director General of Health has published a list with 35 for Northland, so hardly starved.
Well, I haven't seen that list, but there's no doubt that
so why
if you significantly reduce down the number of outlets from six. Yeah, that's right. That's my understanding is there'll be one store in Northland and significantly reduced number around the country and in lots of other parts of the country, you would have just one or two potential stores. That's what happens when you have a licensing
regime. Chris, I've just told you there are 35 in Northland.
Significantly reduce the numbers. Well, I don't know how much further we can take this. My understanding is there's just one available in Northland, but regardless, you're going to see significantly reduced numbers of tobacco outlets, and our view is that will lead to a black market and it will lead to ram raids and those stores becoming Fort Knox. It's the exact opposite of what we want.
I read Treasury's regulatory impact statement for the smoke-free Aotearoa action plan. It suggested the plan would result in $5 billion in health spending savings, $5 billion in productivity gains, and that the plan would save thousands of lives. You say there is no evidence that would be the effect, but your government has said that other changes it would introduce would help to reduce smoking rates instead. What sort of changes might help to reduce smoking rates that your government would support?
Well, New Zealand's smoking rates have been on the decline actually since the last National-led government. The National government of 2008 onwards significantly raised excise on tobacco, introduced plain packaging, for example, as well, a range of other amendments to our smoke-free laws. So our smoking rates have been declining, and we want them to continue to decline as well. We just don't think limited number of stores, the other measures that the government has proposed are the right way to go about doing that. But we do want to see fewer people smoking and taking up smoking, and actually that is what is happening. The other thing that's happened is vaping, of course, has become an alternative to smoking, significantly better for you than nicotine-based tobacco with all of the health complications that come from that. So there's challenges with vaping as well because, some of the evidence is that young kids are taking it up and, we are concerned about that, and I know a lot of parents watching are concerned about that as well. So it's about how you get that balance right between having vaping and other products like that as alternative mechanisms for people to get off smoking, but making sure also that people aren't taking it up, particularly young kids as well. So getting the licensing regime around that is really important. I don't think we've got it right at the moment, frankly. I've got a vaping store that's opening 380 metres from one of my local primary schools in Wainui Mata in my own electorate, and I know a lot of people are really concerned about that. So I don't think we've got the regime right there yet, and I know Shane Retty is doing some work on that.
Finally, Nicola Willis is planning a mini budget before Christmas. Will that include changes that require legislation? And if so, when will that legislation be passed?
You'll have to wait and see when it comes to Nicola's mini budget before Christmas. And so I'm not going to give you a yay or a nay on that. You'll just have to wait and see. But she certainly is intending to publish a mini budget before Christmas, yeah.
That's the new Leader of the House, Chris Bishop. Now, just to confirm, in September, the Director General of Health published this: the maximum numbers of approved smoke tobacco retail premises permitted in areas of New Zealand under the smoke-free law changes. As I explained, the list considered population, travel times and smoking rates. There were just under 600 stores nationwide, including a total of 35 outlets across Northland. Not one, as the Minister believed and as the Prime Minister claimed in his post-CAB press conference this week. We have just posted the list to our X feed, our Twitter feed, so you can check it out for yourself.